Yeah, atrial fibrillation, or a-fib, is basically a disorganized rhythm of the upper chambers of the heart, which are called the atria. So intrinsically, a-fib has always been thought of as a benign rhythm. However, it's been shown that people in a-fib live shorter than people that are not in a-fib, what we call a normal sinus rhythm. And with a-fib, you have various physiologic changes that can happen to cause problems, meaning you can have low flow through the heart, which can cause congestive heart failure, which can cause you to be hospitalized more frequently. You can also have stasis, or again, low flow, which can cause blood clots to form in the heart, which can then fire off to other parts of the heart, meaning the brain or the body or the legs, and cause clotting problems. There's a significant percentage of stroke patients in the country have strokes due to embolic phenomenon from these clots that have formed in the heart due to atrial fibrillation and have then gone off to other parts of the body. Symptoms of AFib are varied. In fact, they can go from completely asymptomatic and people don't even know they have it until maybe they've already had a stroke or they show up with some other problem. Or symptoms can go to a racing heartbeat, palpitation, shortness of breath. Some people have this impending feeling of doom, like they're going to die. And that's usually because of a rapid response to the atrial fibrillation, a rapid heart rate. So the symptoms can really span across the board. But what makes it so insidious and dangerous is oftentimes it is asymptomatic, and you don't know until you've already had a complication from it. If AFib is a standalone issue, often the first-line therapy is medication, and there are antiarrhythmic medications that are given often by the cardiologists and can handle the problem. With atrial fibrillation, you also need to be on blood thinners, anticoagulation, to prevent those blood clots from forming. Depending on the type of atrial fibrillation, whether it's been very short-lived or it's been going on for years, will depend, and if it's managed by medications in and of itself, will determine if you need to do a more invasive approach. So cardiologists, first-line invasive approach is usually with a catheter. They'll take a catheter up through the groin, snake it up to the heart, and they can make burn marks on the inside of the heart to basically try to ablate these areas of the heart that where this abnormal rhythm starts. Patients that have an enlarged heart or have had AFib for a much longer time have a much higher failure rate with catheter ablations. So then that moves to the next step, which is surgical ablation. Surgical ablation, which is relatively new from a minimally invasive standpoint, involves also making burn lesions on the outside of the heart and also getting rid of that left atrial appendage, which is a little portion of the heart where the clot forms that then often can fire off to the body. Historically, surgical ablation involved open chest, open sternotomy, cardiopulmonary bypass, big operation. These days, we can do it with just a few little small port sites, about a centimeter, three on each side, and patient is still under general anesthesia, but patient has significantly less pain, recovers very quickly afterwards, and it has a higher success rate than the catheter ablations for AFib. We usually refer to it as a maze procedure because you're drawing lines that look like a maze on the outside of the heart to keep those electrical rhythms from propagating in the wrong direction.